Hawkins, Tuscaloosa, Alabama. We were the ACA fishing team. Fished the Bassmaster Southern Open on Lake Gunnersville on April the 5th. 295 boats in the tournament. We had a great day on the water, minus an accident that we had. We had a 3:30 weigh-in. The boat ride that morning was about a 44-minute run where we went. So we had to be back at the state park at 3:30. We knew that we had to leave there where we were at around 2:15 to 2:20 to give us time to get back. The wind that day was really blowing out of the south-southwest, 20 to 25 miles an hour. Had turned out on the Tennessee River into some 4-foot swells, rough boat ride. We're running, you know, medium throttle, can't run real fast in that. Really rough. Boat comes out of the water two or three times. The boys are hanging on for dear life. I'm hanging on for dear life. I get down to where the river makes a bend, somewhere near Roseberry, notice that I'm out of the channel a little bit. I had been hugging the right-hand channel, trying to stay out of the waves. We had been to the left side of the river, the right side of the river. We were just trying to get out of the waves. It was rough. And the river had calmed a little bit. We were in 2-foot waves then, and so we were able to pick up our speed a little bit. And I looked up and noticed a buoy in front of me that looked like I was out of the channel. Turned my wheel to the left to correct that and hit an object in the water running about 60 miles an hour. Don't know what it was, think it was a stump. In a split second, we went from cloud nine to me looking over to make sure everybody was alive. The power trim cylinder, it broke the shaft completely loose. Of course, there was fluid that drained out of that. When it came over and hit the deck lid, it broke that off, I'm assuming. The motor came up completely over, hit the deck carpet lid here, and busted the cowling all to pieces. You can see the imprint of the hose here on that, but it busted the cowling when it came over in the boat and flipped all the way forward. I would think the prop went a foot or two over the power poles. It sounded like it was over the back of our head. And then this leash here grabbed, and you can see where it pulled the strap. It's designed to give. And it kept the motor from coming on over in the boat and then brought it back down after it went up. Jackson was sitting next to me to my left in the middle of the boat seat. Slung him into the console, into me, slung my son around in the bottom of the boat. The boat immediately stops, turns us left and stops. And of course, my son Hunter was extremely nervous because of the back deck lid was all tore up, the carpet was all eat up. We thought we had busted the fiberglass. We really thought the motor had, you know, broke off the boat. To our surprise, when we all calmed down, the motor was still running. And so I immediately tried to trim the motor up to see if I could see. I was expecting to see no foot on my boat. The motor wouldn't trim up. So I put it in neutral and put it back in gear, and the boat moved. And so I told the boys, I said, it's 2:46. We've got 45 minutes to get to weigh in. We've got about 20 more miles of river to go. We're going to see if it'll run. And we took off and planed up. And my son said, you know, hey, you're going to tear the motor up, tear something up. And I said, well, it's tore up. Now we're going to try to make it back. And so we ran 20-something miles with no trim back to the Gunnersville State Park.
Kind of that night after dinner, we kind of sat down and put our heads together and figured out that we were just going to go for broke and run about 45 miles upriver where some fish had been biting prior to that day. It took us about 45 minutes to get up there. So that day we're fishing, and we get us a good limit, throw probably 5 casts and catch a 4-8 to finish off our limit. That fish kind of got us on cloud 9. We got an hour to make it back on a 40-minute run that morning, and we know the wind's picked up, so it's going to be a rough ride. And we get out of our creek onto the Tennessee River, and there's 4.5 and 5-foot swells, and we kind of look at each other like we've never been in this kind of water before. It's kind of sketchy to us. And notice Dad turns around and notices he's kind of out of the channel, and that's when we struck some object under the water, don't really know what it was, at about 60 miles an hour, and heard the humbling sound of a propeller above your head at 5,300 RPMs. That's a moment you don't ever want to hear. That's when you look at your partner and you just kind of have to sit there and think for a second and thank the Lord that you're still here. I don't know that I could honestly ever step foot in a boat without one now. That I know that that is almost positively the only reason that we're still walking and being able to fish and do what we love for the rest of our lives. I couldn't see myself ever buying a boat without putting one on it or getting in a boat without one knowing that it could have gone that bad.
I don't know that I would ever own another boat without one, ever. And I've got the father of my son's partner that is the same way. I went and bought my dad one. He's bought several of his friends one. I don't think anybody that owns a bass boat that has a high-powered, a high-horsepower motor should run a boat without one, period. Without the leash, I don't know that this picture could be taken on this date. I think there would have been might have been a different outcome without it on the boat. ¶¶